little map of the museum itself. You go in here in the entrance, and there is the admissions and sales booth here. And then you can see that it is pointed out in the various places where the different exhibits are. So we have geology and fossils.
Society was founded in January 1823.
next entry had been by letter of introduction from a member of the Lit and Phil, but from 1827 the public were allowed in at a charge of 1 shilling 5 pence, with free admission on the first Monday of each month, provided that all who visit are expected to come in decent clothes, of course. For a short time, a paid curator was hired at £20 per annum, but financial stringency, even in those days, led to this first being halved, and then the post abolished. However, the curator, Martin Simpson, continued to work on a voluntary basis, supporting himself by selling fossils to visitors. His work in identifying fossils, especially the various species of ammonites, became of national importance, as is our collection. The collections continued to expand partly by design, partly by accident. Between 1867 and 1876, the accidental discovery of some objects from the Anglian Abbey during building operations in a yard behind Church Street gave birth to our archaeological collection. Among them were a leaden seal with the name of Archdeacon Boniface of Rome below left here, and two very rare combs, one with a runic inscription below right. The inscription on this bone comb reads, "My God, may Almighty God help Sigh." It must be somebody's name, maybe. And this Victorian gentleman is Martin Simpson, the first curator. Supported himself by selling fossils to visitors in boxes like the one above. Thank you. Egyptian mummy is said to have left the museum propped in the passenger seat of a sports car, driven by the curator from Hull, who had come to collect it. Reportedly swapped by a drunken Frenchman in Dieppe for two cases of especially ceased in 1960. was occupied by hyenas, and here the remains of their food was found, including lion, wolf, bear, and woolly rhinoceros. At that time, an ice sheet spread southward from Scotland and across much of northern England, and along the western side of the North Sea basin, where it abutted against the North Yorkshire coast and spread inland for several miles. But the North York moors remained largely ice-free. The Vale of Pickering formed a lake. When the ice melted, successes.